SendToMediaPlayer allows you to take media files that are sitting on shared storage or some other network location and transfer them into the media players of a TriCaster, VMC, or VizVector system. Now, there are a couple things in order to get this workflow to operate. It is a little manual, so I'm going to take you through all the steps that need to occur for this to work. The first thing is we need to have the proper kind of setup. And what that means is that the media files that we want to transfer between, let's say, our external machine that we're, you know, browsing the files from and the TriCaster, they need to appear the same way. Specifically, if I open up my laptop here, you can see that I have a network drive that is the Z drive, right? That drive is mounted as the Z drive both on my laptop and on the TriCaster. So the drive letter needs to match, and then the path inside that drive letter needs to match as well. So that way, when one system sends the command over, the TriCaster will see the same exact file path, file, drive letter, all of that kind of stuff when it's told to do this. If they do not match, it will not be able to load the files. Now, if you don't have a shared volume, I'm using NewTek Remote Storage in my case to do that, but it could be other shared NAS type solutions. You could just share your drive on your system. So again, you just have to make sure the drive letter match. So if your is drive D, let's say on your other computer, well, drive D is likely to be used on the TriCaster. You would need to change that drive letter, then share the root of that drive, and that should work. Or you might be able to use something like the subst command, S-U-B-S-T. I'm not going to go through how that command works, but that allows you to do some substitution of alternate drive letters and paths and stuff. So that might also work. But the simplest solution is going to be a shared storage volume, right, that both systems see mounted exactly as the same drive letter. So if you're in that situation and you can get that set up, then this workflow can work. Once you've done that, you're going to download the SendToMediaPlayer application from the website. You're going to unzip it. And inside this folder, there are two things you're going to see. You're going to see a program called curl.exe. You're going to leave that one alone. And then you're going to see a file called sendtoddr1.bat. The .bat might be hidden if you have extensions turned off, but it will say sendtoddr in there. Now, what you're going to do is you're going to go into this sendtoddr1, and we're going to start modifying this so that we can set up all the proper information as to how we want the script to work. If you want to have multiple scripts to, like, let's say, have another one for sendtoddr2 or sendtographics1 or sendtosound, you can do that. You're just going to create duplicates of this file and then modify each duplicate with its changes. And in fact, you can even have some set with transcode and some not. So effectively, I give you one file to start with. We'll go through that one, and then you can just do the same process over and over again as you have more. So if you right-click on this file, an edit option should appear in the menu. And this will open up the file in Notepad. Now, the part you're going to edit is from where it says edit starts here down to where it says edit stops here. So in here, I've kind of labeled everything that you need to do. Most of them are already set with preset commands. So in some cases, you might not have to change anything. But there are going to be a couple you're most likely going to need to change. The first one is this set TriCaster IP address or computer name. So where it says set IP TriCaster equal, you need to change after that equal sign that number to be the IP address of your computer, or you can also put the name of your TriCaster in if you want to use that as well. Either should work. IP addresses are probably always the safest way to go, but there's no reason a computer name shouldn't work. So if you want to use that, you can use that as well. That you have to do, because otherwise it's not going to be able to determine where the command needs to be sent to talk to your TriCaster. So this tells it, here's my TriCaster on the network, and then it knows how to talk to it. The next thing we need is whether or not live panel authentication is enabled or not. So this is in the administrative mode window. If you have this turned on, then you have to fill this in. If you don't have it turned on, then just leave it alone. Don't change anything. Just leave it like it is. But if you have it turned on, the way you would type this in would be admin is the username, and then you put a colon, and then you would type in whatever the appropriate password is. So maybe that would also be admin, which is the default, or you could change it if you've put in a different password, what you want it to be. In my case, I currently have the live panel password disabled, so I'm going to leave it blank. The next one is which media player we want this script to target. Now, it's by default in here set to DDR1, but you can change this, and I list in here all of the different options you can set it to. So it could be DDR1, DDR2, potentially up to DDR4 if you have a system with four DDRs, GFX1 or GFX2 or sound. So you would just type that word in just like you see in this upper area. Let's say I'm just going to leave mine on DDR1, but you know, if you wanted to, obviously you just change it to a 2 in there. The next one is if you want a transcode to occur when these files have been imported. Now, first of all, transcode only applies when it is a DDR target. Now, it's not going to give you an error if you have it turned on with the other ones, but you can't transcode images or sound. So just realize that even if you have it on, you're just making the system telling it to do something it can't do anyways. If you have this, so here's what happens between on and off. If you have it on off or no, as you can see in here where it says set transcode to no, it will tell the TriCaster to load the files, and the files will play from the original location that they currently are. So like on my case, I have a Z drive. So when I point the files that I want into the DDR, they're going to play off the Z drive over the network into the system. And that's fine, right? As long as your shared storage is fast enough to deliver the frames of video, you can work that way. If you change this to yes, then as each file gets placed in the DDR, then the TriCaster will be issued a transcode command on that file. And at that point, it will start processing it in the background and creating a local copy on a TriCaster hard drive. Now, this drive will be whatever drive the session is located on. And this can take some time, obviously, because it's converting the media, you know, also into the native SpeedHQ format that TriCaster works with. So this might not be something, it won't interrupt a live production, but obviously it does slow things down if you're trying to instantly access this media. So transcode's probably best if you're doing this ahead of time, or if there's small clips in there. So you can change this to yes or no based upon what you want in there. Finally, the last one is if you want a timeout. Now, when this script runs, by default, a little DOS window is going to open up, and I do have it report information about what it's going on in there. It will tell you which DDR and what clip is being sent, and it even gives you a final total of how many clips were issued, sent in, so you can kind of like, if you know you're supposed to send 20, right, it will tell you at the end there's 20. However, if you want to see this information, you would want to put a timeout delay. And this number is in seconds. So if you leave it on zero, as soon as it finishes, the window will instantly go away. If you want a 10-second timeout, so the window stays up 10 seconds after you have processed it, you could put 10 in there. Now, you can always press a key and it will, you know, escape out of the window early. But that's just a question of, you know, do you want this window to stay up for a few seconds afterwards? So I'm going to leave mine on zero. I will show you how you can also hide the window so that it will work that way if you don't want any on-screen thing to occur. So that is the changes you need to make. So once you've done all that, you're going to save this. And then if you had another one, let's just quickly say I want to have a send to DDR2. I can copy this, and then I can paste a copy, and in here, we'll rename my script to send to DDR2. And then all I have to do is go and edit this new copy and say, hey, this is DDR2. And let's say DDR2 is going to receive a transcode. So we'll change this to a yes in here as well and save that. And now I have, and I would just keep doing that process for as many scripts as I want. If I want to send to graphics, sound, you know, maybe I want a DDR1 with transcode and a DDR1 without transcode, you could then rename the names of these, you know, file names in here with that kind of information as well. So go in, create the number of scripts you need, name them that what makes sense to you, and then we're ready to proceed on to the next part. The next part is we need to make links to these files so that we can easily access them from either the desktop or from the right-click menu. Now, this folder that we have created, you can place this folder anywhere in your system that you want, right? It doesn't have to be on the desktop. I'm doing it on the desktop, but if you want to put it on a, you know, your C drive somewhere or your D drive somewhere, it doesn't matter. There's no installation for it. But then what we want to do is right click on these files and choose the create shortcut option. And I'm going to do that for both of these here. All right, now these shortcuts point to the batch files. And the nice thing is I can then place these shortcuts where I'd like. Maybe I want them on the desktop of my computer, right? Then we'll show you how that method will work. And then I'll show you how you can right click to access these. So now that they're on the desktop of my computer, we can further rename these. You know, maybe I don't want these, you know, the dot bat and the shortcut in there. We can do, or rename them to even something else completely if I wanted to. There we go. If you want to get rid of the DOS window that pops up, you can right click on this icon, do a properties on it. And in the window that appears, there are some controls in here, like you can, where it says run, you can put this into a minimized state. And then the window that would open will be minimized and it won't get in the way. Or you could leave it normal, which will then just, you'll see it appear again with the information that dumps out. So you can play with that and see what you'd like. One other thing you can also do is if you don't like the generic little icon it has, you can hit the change icon in here and go find or load in your own icon. So I'm just make it look a little nicer here. I'm going to grab this one. It's like a little blue arrow and apply that. So it's kind of represents the media player in there. And I can go do that on both of those. All right. So once you've got your files ready, then we're ready to start using the workflow. So the way the workflow works is that you're gonna open up your target drive. So this is my Z drive. I'm gonna go find some media. So let's look in here. I've got a bunch of video files. And then you can either take an individual file and drop it on the appropriate icon. This is one way you can do it. Or you can select a range of files holding like the shift key and you could drop it on and then that will issue a bunch of commands over and over again to send all of those files. So let's just take a quick look here. Now you can see my computer and the TriCaster. I'm going to drop a bunch of files into DDR1 and you can see them all appearing in the media player ready to be used. And now if I take another file, let's just grab one like, something a little shorter here, this one. If I drop this on DDR2, right, you'll see that it's doing that. And that has also now issued the transcode command. And it might be a little hard to see, but if we go in here and look, you can see that the little T icon has a blue line going around it, and it is slowly transcoding that file. Once that's done, you'll see that the path of this will change from the Z drive that it currently points to. It will get replaced by the file that it has created, which I believe in this case will be on the D drive, and the little T will go away. And at that point, you now have a local copy of this file on the system that you're now using, and it's no longer, if the network drive volume letter went away or whatever, for whatever reason, that's okay. You're still using your own copy. So it's almost done. And now if we look, we can see now it's on the D drive, right? It just instantly swapped it from one to the other. So that's how the workflow works. Now, the last thing I want to show is how you can set this up with a right-click menu. Let's say you don't want to drop these on the desktop. You'd rather right-click on these and have them appear in the Send To menu so that they can appear in here. Here's how you can do that. Open another Explorer window. So we'll get another one here. And then in the path of the Explorer window, type the following. Type shell, S-H-E-L-L, colon, Send To. And if you type that in, this will take you to the Send To right-click menu inside of Windows for the current user. And now I can take these two files I've created and I can create copies of these or just move these depending upon what I want in there. So let's just create some copies. So I'll just go right click, copy them. Now you can see them appear in here. We can close this down. And now if I go in here, I can take an individual file, right click, and you can see that in my Send To menu, it now has my Send To DDR1, Send To DDR2, or of course, however many that I might have put in there if that's what you want to do. So just to show this work really quick, we'll go back to my side-by-side mode and let's send this to DDR1. I'll send it to DDR1, and you can see a new clip appear in DDR1. And if I want to, I can send this one to DDR2. That one will appear in DDR2 and be issued a transcode command on top of it.